Thank you. By the blessings of Goddess Saraswati, I would like to start this event. Before we begin, I would like to introduce my esteemed panelists to you. We have Dr. Gopal Mugaraya, Director of NIT Goa. We welcome you, sir. We have Professor Dr. N. Rajendran, Vice Chancellor of Algappa University. We welcome you, sir. We have Professor Dr. M. Krishnan, Vice Chancellor of Madurai Kamaraj University. We welcome you, sir. We have Professor Dr. Aditya Malik, Vice Chancellor of K.R. Mangalam University. We again welcome you, sir. We have Professor Dr. Abhay Kumar, Vice Chancellor of IEC University. We welcome you, sir. We have Professor Dr. Nagaraj Ramarao, Vice Chancellor of Kalasalingam University. We welcome you, sir. We welcome Professor Dr. Nagaraj Ramarao, Vice Chancellor of Kalasalingam University. I feel truly blessed to have such a power-packed panel with me today. We are still getting a lot of calls, and I have been asked to just, you know, before we begin, just wait for one more minute, as a lot of people are still getting the links and they are trying to join. So, welcome, gentlemen. Thank you so much again. My first question, and what I've thought is, I would be asking a small question. All of you can answer that question in 2 to 3 minutes. And based on that, we would like to take the conversation. You all are great administrators running large universities, and we would like that the audience should understand how do you make decisions, how do you run institutions. And these are very strange times. Nobody in the world has seen what has happened now. So these were all very new things for all of us. And during these times, the decisions that you have taken have been really great. So my first question is, what happened to your campus when the COVID situation came up? What were your first thoughts? Did you anticipate that this is going to be a long-term lockdown? And what were the first thoughts and what were the first decisions that you made? I would request Dr. Gopal Mugaraya to please share his thoughts first, and post that then we will have all the other panelists. My humble request with very, very humbly, I request all the panelists to please keep your answers between 2 to 3 minutes so that we can share more content with the audience. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Gurudev, and good afternoon, respected panelists and my dear friend. Gurudev, with your permission, I want to little deviate because you have directly come to the topic. I mean, it's always better to be based on that. See, COVID, always you should attack the cause, not the symptom. COVID is only symptom. For education should not be based on COVID crisis. COVID is an excuse and it's an opportunity for us. But what is exactly thing is, we have been talking about ICT online for years together, but we have not done it. Now, use of ICT in the teaching learning process has not happened. Thanks to COVID-19, which has put the entire humanity on a severe jolt, socially, economically, and emotionally. So, maybe a shocking experience for all of us. But see, as our honorable CM told once, Jeevan our Shikshana. First, you have to, you know, safeguard our Jeeva. Jeeva means our health and our body. Jeevan means the life, and Shikshan is less. But I would say, with the permission of you, I would like to tell 2-3 words, which may be a base, because we are such a scholarly panel with us. It becomes a very good experience for us to talk on that. Friends, if you see, it is said that if you want to attack a country, don't bring any force. Just dilute the education standard, that country is gone. So it's said that if you want to develop a good country, you have to have a very strong education base. You know, it's said that Sa Vidyaya Vimuktaye. That means that in Shikshan, Hamara Janjar Se Bahar Nikalna Hai. But our education doesn't do that. Does it answer this? Sa Vidyaya Vimuktaye. So our education talks about excellence, but never talks about the relevance. Never talks about relevance. So skill component is completely missing. It was a shock for us when we said you have to go for online. But we did that. We did that. So one of the important things we have to see in this context of online is that the education is not pumping the information through online. It is a training of mind to think. Exactly the definition of the teaching learning process. So what we decided as soon as the COVID came, we thought is a cake and icing model. Cake should be the teaching learning process in the class, face to face. icing is what to do on online, because we always know that online teaching will not be a replacement for classroom teaching. It's only a supplement. A paryay nahi hai, a purak hai. Exactly, we thought about it. Yes.
And sir, what was the time when you decided that you would be going under complete lockdown?
See, fortunately, as you know, NIT Goa is an infant institution. It's coming up institution. We had a shortage of facilities. So we have been doing a lot of course on online also, virtual class, virtual labs. So it's not a new thing for us. It's not an immediate crisis. See, I was the director of NIT Agartala. There was a different story. But in NIT Goa, we are yet to build a campus. We are in a temporary campus. We have been doing this, both IIT and NIT, we have been doing this online coaching, teaching before also. But this has become inevitable for us. It's like a crisis management. But I'm very happy that it has done so. In fact, we have graduated our students. We have completed our courses. We have completed our evaluation. And the final year students have got the degree on 15th of this year. All students.
Okay.
Yes, NIT Goa, all students got job. I mean, they got job model. They got the degree also. Provision certificate is signed by director on 15th.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Moving on now to Honorable Professor Dr. N. Rajendran. Sir, my question to you is the same. What was your first reaction when you got to know about COVID? And when you, I'm sure you would have got information much beforehand that institutions are going to go under a lockdown, the university campus would be going under a lockdown. And what did you tell your affiliated colleges, since Algappa University is a state university? What were your instructions to the colleges, and what was that moment? Can you tell us more about that?
Yes, Gurudev, good afternoon, and good afternoon to all the learned panelists. In fact, the situation is something very new to us. That is because we never experienced in my lifetime a situation like this. This is a very honest submission that is from my side. In fact, I was on the eve of going to Japan on 15th of March, and we have been following what's happening across the world, particularly in China, in the Wuhan, and all our WhatsApp messages and the information, and also the news bulletins that is coming across the world. I was saying that something is happening in Wuhan, the city of Wuhan, because last year, I would like to recall here, I was in China exactly the same year, April 2019, for about 10 to 15 days. We were there in Beijing, and then Tangshan, and then Shanghai, and all these places. But yet, we consider very fortunate now. We are not this year. The most important thing is we never thought this would touch us so drastically as it is done now. That is my honest, again, confession. We thought that was only the beginning resemblance and beginning stages of COVID in India. But the government has taken a very wise step, I must say, very correct step in locking down. But when the lockdown came, we never ready for the entire impact of it. That is the real situation. Because this is a new situation for us. Because we evolved certain strategies. As we experienced the lockdown, we thought the lockdown would go away in a matter of 10 or 15 days, or even at the most 30 days. But it is continuing for more than 3 months now, in the sense of partial lockdown here and there, and also curfew situation. And the kind of, say, sanitization and also health measures that we have to take, social distancing apart. So no students, but yet teachers, half the teachers present, and half the administrative staff present. So these are the situation never happened to us. We have, this is in a hectic period, though the months of May and June technically are vacation months for any university, most universities across India. But yet we used to have a lot of programs, development program, because we are a recipient of this USA grant from MHRD. Hence, our program is an ongoing program, even during vacation. And suddenly, we thought first we must safeguard. Seeing the intensity of COVID, we thought everybody must be safeguarded first. So our first alert to all the students and all the staff members, administrative staff and everybody was to keep away from the university. Even I have kept myself away from the university for the first 15 days because I did not enter the university campus, although I just lived across the university campus. I did not enter the first 15 days. But later on, slowly I mustered courage, and then I started entering my office at least first in 4 months, and this encouraged others also to come in, and now we have almost a full swing, and I think our strategies slowly evolve. We never anticipated the kind of impact the COVID create, especially a region like Shivaganga. But fortunately, Shivaganga is not in the red alert list as far as COVID.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. This is something that none of us had ever anticipated that this would ever happen. And I truly understand. And I think now we are in a position where we should always be ready for any kind of lockdown that can happen anytime. So I'm sure that you would be taking a lot of steps towards that, and we would be coming in our next round of questions. I would request Honorable Dr. M. Krishnan to please share his views on what were the first reactions and what were the first decisions that you made when you got to know about COVID, and what were the important notices that you gave to your staff and to the affiliated colleges. I would request you to lay more stress on your guidance that has gone towards the affiliated colleges. Dr. Krishnan.
Good afternoon to everybody. I am much thankful to you to have such a wonderful discussion about that the university what they have taken for the COVID situation. In Madurai Kamaraj University, particularly if you are talking, up to March 15, we are hearing the news here and there. There is a virus infecting to the public and it's going to have a lot of problem in the society. But later, exactly March 23, 23rd, actually we got the information, we are going for the lockdown. So immediately after lockdown, Madurai Kamaraj University, you know that it's a rural-oriented university. There are about 75 villages around Madurai Kamaraj University. The people are coming from these villages, and when I called the people, and then if I am instructing that there is a virus is infecting, so be careful, and we are in the lockdown. But nobody believes that. Nobody, they don't want to go away from the university. Even particularly students, if you are talking, they don't want to leave the hostels. But when the GO came from the Tamil Nadu government, we compelled the people to go out from the university. It's completely locked down. But 1 week or 2 weeks, we don't know what we are going to do that. We passed the message to all the affiliated colleges, because you know that we have more than 100 affiliated colleges. I instructed all the college principal. There is an instruction, please take care of that. Particularly, the students coming out from that Tamil Nadu, they should go to their places immediately and take care of their travel and everything. That instruction was given immediately. Particularly, the girl students disposed immediately with a lot of care. Nothing happened. Nothing, what you called unwanted incidents were happened in the university area. But if it's going in April middle, what we thought that, I think everybody is working. Doctors are working. Police officers are working, students are working. We don't know what we can do that. That time I thought that why educational institutions are not taking part in the prevention of the corona. Then I thought that, I called that one of the NGOs here in Madurai, Chellamuthu Trust. Then another very famous institutes, everybody knows that, NIMHANS at Bangalore, where they are giving lot of information about that the COVID or any disaster comes, how the people are affecting psychologically or sociologically, economically. So we joined, the three groups are joined together. I mean, Madurai Kamaraj University, there is one NGO at Madurai, that Chellamuthu Trust, and also NIMHANS Bangalore. we thought that, okay, the affected people are infected people, were taken care of that, what you called the doctors, police officers, and the nurses. But the people not affected by the disease or the virus, they have a lot of problem. One side, everybody thought that, I mean, we are not going to be infected by this virus. Another group of people, what they thought that, okay, what we are going to do that? We have to go away from the village, or we have to go away from the city, or we have to go from that, what you call the state. Such a way they are thinking. There is no job. There is no agriculture work. Nothing is there. So what we thought that, now we have to give some psychological, I mean, they got some psychological problem. So we trained the students. What I can say that, first we brought the NSS students of our university to the university, following that what you called the social distance and other, whatever the instruction government is giving. And we are giving the training to the students. What are the steps? What is the corona first? What is the corona? How it's infecting? How it's spreading? And how you have to take care of that? So you have to, what you called, I mean, know about the coronavirus. Then only you can away from this particular disease. So for that, we had given training to the students. But immediately, if you are seeing, almost all college students, they want to have the training because they are coming from the village. Why it's happened, if we April end, if you are coming, there is a, what you called the suicides, and there are the psychological problem. They are not taking the steps properly, decision properly. So what happened? Every college students, they want to have the training. So first step, Madurai Kamaraj University, what they have done it, or our professors done it, train the students and they have to teach or give the instruction to the public. Kindly take care of yourself. Nothing will come to you if you are away from the disease. Like that, we trained near about 1,500 students from 20 colleges. The training is still going on. This is the one side we are going. Another side, I mean, instruction came from the government of Tamil Nadu. We are giving the specialized courses to the students and also the teachers. What is the virus? Infectious diseases. But how it's going to prevent it? Then what is the virology? Viral diseases. And also, what are the disease available? These are the things we are giving as a course. The students are not only from Tamil Nadu, near about 500 participants are taking part of this course and we are giving the training. But one thing I have to accept it here, nobody knows that when it's going to end. When it's going to be end. I mean, if you are starting, if you are seeing that one side, we are happy. Why? Because our death rate was very low, but that also is going very fast. So we all come together, work together, and then we have to come to a conclusion or decision how we are going to safeguard our public, particularly people living in the poor villages. With this, I will thank you very much once again, and I will join this panel discussion later. Thank you very much.
Sir, first of all, congratulations. Your association with the NGO and your decision to train the students, I think it's purely out of the box.
Yes.
Because at a vice chancellor level, you have been able to make an impact on more than 1,500 students. And every student, if he or she is impacting minimum 5 people across Tamil Nadu, I believe a great job has been done.
Yes.
Dr. Krishna, I will again come back to you later, and then I will ask you about the famous ventilator that MKU has developed.
Yes,
but
yes.
That will do in the next round because we have 3 more panelists who are yet to answer this question. So I would now go to Professor Dr. Nagaraj Ram Rao to tell us immediately.
Yeah, please.
Two first decisions that he made as a vice chancellor when he got to know about this.
Good afternoon, all of you once again. As
voice is not very clear, sir.
Most of the panelists have been telling. We all went to the
professor. Your
voice
audio
is not clear.
Can you please
your voice is
your
not very clear.
It's not audible at all, or we did a testing, right, Gurudev? Hello.
Sir, your audio is clear, but your video is not clear.
Okay. I'll continue talking. Probably we could set it right gradually. I'm getting a clear picture on my screen here, which is coming from your end.
Sir, both voice and video is having they are breaking. Continuously, I'm not getting it. Your voice. Please, check it.
No. Am I audible now?
Audible, but the thing is there is a break in between.
Go ahead. We can hear you. Go ahead, please.
Okay, you can go ahead. We will see that.
Thank you. All of us were, as people have been telling, totally unprepared for this COVID situation. We all went into it.
Dr. Nagaraj Ramarao, I would come back to you later because there is some problem with the internet you have. Please, I would request you to please have a look at the internet connection once, and if possible, please change the net source. I would request now Dr. Aditya Malik to please share his views. What were the immediate two decisions you took when you heard about this?
First of all,
Dr. Aditya Malik.
Thank you so much for inviting me to be on this very eminent panel. It's a delight to be with my other esteemed vice chancellors from all over the country. And I also welcome our attendees and viewers who are listening. And I think the platform is a wonderful one. So congratulations to you, Gurudev, for organizing this. Many of the things that have been said are similar, and we had to take some decisions very quickly. In fact, on the 15th of March itself, we took a consultative decision in the leadership team, although things were not absolutely clear at that point of time. The extent of the pandemic and how it's going to affect India, it seemed as though in India things were going to move more smoothly than in other countries, for example in China or parts of Europe where it was catching up so fast. We seemed to have measures in place that was going to limit it. Of course, things have moved and shifted since then. So on the 15th of March, then I asked our students, and the majority of students are day students. They come in our own transportation from all different regions of Delhi NCR, from Noida, Gurgaon, parts of East Delhi and so on, to please stay at home, because of our concern with their safety and the developing situation. And faculty continue to come onto campus for about a week. And then on the 22nd, the Prime Minister had that first day of staying at home. And then soon, as one of my colleagues has pointed out, on the 23rd, there was a directive that there's going to be a lockdown. From the 15th itself, we started, and I have to, also congratulate my faculty for adapting very quickly. We're still adapting. They started teaching online right away from the 15th of March. We chose a platform that we could do that with, and that sort of teaching began. So, but then on the 23rd, then we had to take a decision to also ask faculty to stay at home because the situation was now becoming very uncertain. And so also, students living in the hostel, we asked them to pack up and go home because it was not sure, what's going to happen with train travel, bus travel, and many students coming from far parts, from Assam and, other Bihar,
Hello?
India. So that's one I took. And then we began with the online teaching straight away. Two things that we put in place straight away. One was also, there's somebody's talking in the...
I would just like the host to have a look at that. Dr. Malik, you can please...
All right, so
hello.
A couple of things that we put in place was one... a psychological counseling center for both an online psychological counseling center for faculty and students. And that has been used very extensively. We have a psychology department and, faculty there offered themselves. And that was done almost on a daily basis that students were calling up and having one-on-one conversations. We also set up, guidelines, a protocol for how to manage yourself, in the COVID-19 situation. That was posted to all the students, to the parents immediately. So we began, online teaching straight away. And then we also thought of how to engage our students in this very uncertain situation, very new situation, strange situation, developing situation. So one of the things we very quickly put together was a student-driven pan-university project on COVID-19. And, you know, about 1,000 students signed up for this, and they began to sort of educate themselves in depth about all the dimensions of, you know, the pandemic, you know, from, you know, making sanitizers, hand sanitizers, to drone sanitizers, to the spread of the disease, where it started, what's going to happen post COVID-19, what are the legal implications, what are the financial implications. So that was a very successful project, a cross-disciplinary project, you know, in which students from pharmacy, legal studies, architecture, for example, worked together. So our teaching was done part of the day online, and the other part of the day, you know, students and faculty were engaged in this project work. And that was very fruitful, and that went on till almost till May, you know, end of April, May, the entire 3 months. And there's a lot of material that has come out of it, and students have been very, very appreciative of that initiative. Then we put in, you know, many other initiatives. If you like, I can tell you about, you know, lots of webinars with industry leaders, with top senior educationists, with writers.
I believe we would come to that in the next.
We can come to that later, and, you know, also talk about what we did with exams and so on. But these were a couple of initial decisions that we took, and we put these things into place right in the beginning, you know, in mid-March, for our campus.
Okay, I would now go to Professor Dr. Abhay Kumar. One decision that you feel was most important decision immediately when you heard about lockdown. Yeah. Of course, I know that one is that it has to be a lockdown.
I know. I'll be very brief about it. Don't worry. Mr. Gurudeva, very good afternoon, and good afternoon to all the distinguished panelists here, plus all the attendees and audience in the MLU. In fact, I'll give you one or two instances how it happened. Initially, in the first week of March, we had planned an international conference for the 14th of March, and none of the international participants could come. Still, the Himachal Pradesh Private University Regulatory Commission gave us the go-ahead to do it, since we had invited everyone, booked hotels and all, keeping certain distances in mind, social distancing in mind, and we went ahead and did the conference. On the 19th of March, we had an annual convocation, which His Excellency the Governor was supposed to be the chief guest for. We got a call from His Excellency's office that let's postpone it, he'll be there as the chief guest, and the date would come at least 1 or 2 months later. So we had an idea something is boiling up. We had anticipated that things would be somehow or the other different in the times to come. So somewhere around the 14th of March, soon after the conference ended, a school of pharmacy took the lead. In fact, Baddi, where we are situated, being the biggest pharmacy hub in Asia. So yes. The students produced about 100 liters of sanitizers and educated the villagers around. They prepared it in the lab and educated the villagers around as to how to use it, because that was to be used. They had read it everywhere. So now this is how it started. On the 17th of March, we unilaterally asked our students not to come. The faculty were coming, because we had this from the government in Shimla that things are going to change now. So what to do next? Next was that online teaching. Nobody had anticipated that this pandemic would be of this nature, and we even don't know what would the new normal actually be. So keeping in that mind, the few steps we had taken was, initially, every faculty member was asked to teach the students, whether it was through online teaching methodology by uploading videos on YouTube, by sending mailers, by uploading course materials on the website, or using WhatsApp groups. You know, this was how we went. We all scrambled to somehow teach our students initially, and I'll be very honest about that. Later on, when we graduated, and we knew that we were here to stay, and the first lockdown was there. So then at that point of time, say around 27th of March, we started proper online teaching on the platforms like Zoom. Then we had an LMS in place. So all these things then started. We asked the faculty members of each dean of each school to get the timetable prepared, slots made, the students were intimated. But the first online classes for 3 days which we conducted was to educate the students about COVID and its effects. Now every student must understand that what COVID is, and because till you know exactly what the ailment is, what the virus is, how can you try to protect yourself
from
the environment around? So this is how it went for 3-4 days. Then we had frantic calls from the faculty. One or two offers were already withdrawn. So we in fact had a very good relationship with the industries in Baddi. We talked to them, and maybe the students would not remain unemployed even if they may be underemployed for a year or two. We decided on this somehow. And this is the initial reaction we had. So I would be very brief about it.
What I really love, Professor, was you manufacture in 100,000 liters of
100. Only
100. 100 liters of sanitizer during March itself. Because I think this is the impact that really people around us want to see. What is the impact that education institutions create? And who would have thought that a university would create 100 liters of sanitizers, or who would have thought that a university would create ventilators? I think necessity is the mother of invention. I think this is the best example. Again, coming back to Professor Dr. Nagaraj Ramrao, sir, I believe you are there online and with, hello. Sir, you are on mute. Dr. Nagaraj Ramrao, you are on mute. Can you please unmute yourself, sir? Professor Nagaraj, you are still on mute. Okay. Requesting host.
I think make a phone call, Mr. Gurudev, so that he is not able to probably hear you also.
Oh. Yeah, now I have unmuted him. Yes, thank sir, please continue.
Thank you. Yeah.
This is one. So my question is, what was the most important decision that you felt you took when you got to know about the lockdown?
See, as I was trying to tell earlier, we all went into the lockdown without any preparation. It was like it came off all of a sudden to all of us. You were hearing the news about the virus here and there, but suddenly one day you are asked to close all your businesses. It is like, you know, I'm a person with who does research with artificial intelligence and neural networks. It is like getting into an unknown system and training your own neural network and make it learn how the system is going to function in future. So it was similar to that when this came to us, and there was a circular that you need to lock down and you need to send out the students from the university. The first and foremost thing that came into my mind was the safety of my students. It was like I was responsible to send them safe to their homes, and the time given was very limited. So and students from far off places do come to my university. So first concern was the safety of the students and making them reach their homes safely. So after that, it was business as usual. Like Professor, the director of NIT Goa was telling, we have been doing this digital pedagogy and teaching students online from quite a long time. It was not all new to us. We started the regular classes as per the timetable, and the syllabus was continued. The portions were covered, and then, you know, the statutory bodies, I should congratulate the statutory bodies, the UGC and the AICTE, they came in very handy. And you know, the UGC constituted an expert committee to deal with this pandemic situation, and wherein very, very good instructions empowering the universities in terms of how the examinations could be conducted, how a practical examination could be conducted, how those PhD bioverses could be conducted. Very explicit instructions were given, and they were on advisory basis. It was not impending on the universities to straight away adapt them, but it was of advisory nature, but very, very meaningful and very, very timely advices which came from the statutory bodies helped us in, you know, completing the academics, completing those examinations, declaring the results and make the students eligible to get into their placements. That was the first and foremost thing. And parallelly, we have done a lot of things which we wouldn't have done in a normal situation. Like, you know, the now innumerable webinars, innumerable workshops, innumerable, expert talks that were conducted by the university, because world became more closer, we became a global village in real sense, because we could access those professors, we could access those experts worldwide and invite them, like you have invited us today for this conference. We could invite them, if it was a physical presence, you would have definitely not had them amongst you. They were very forthcoming, and we were having lectures, talks from these experts to faculty as well as to the students. We were able to organize international conferences also, the department level conferences. And
on the teaching learning processes, the ethics of teaching and learning processes, and what is the kind of relationship between a teacher and a student during the lockdown? Can you please throw some light on this, sir?
To synthesize the knowledge out of this information. So the job of a teacher is to convert that information into knowledge and then into money. Now what's happening is now in the present system is that it's not to be taken negatively. I'm not blaming the present system, including I'm as a professor. So we spend in the university system 16 weeks in a semester to teach, and we take about 7 to 8 weeks to evaluate. Generally, I'm telling you. Now, when you come to the online process, it will be routinely done, so that the lag period can be reduced. Second thing is, student can decide what exactly the material he has to deal. So the student should decide what exactly he has to learn. As I told, that RI has come now, it is an important aspect that teaching learning process in the classroom as well as the online should be included. But there are some advantages of classroom teaching is learning together, working together, and excelling together is an art. See, for example, if at all I'm smart, I spent 7 years in my hostel life in NIT Suratkal. That made me what I am today. So that will be missing in the online teaching learning process. But I have seen many of these youngsters and teachers now, they use this teaching guide like overhead projector or PPT as a tool, and they become asleep. In fact, many teachers cannot teach without PPT. And it has come to that stage. That's why I always say, power corrupts a politician and PowerPoint corrupts a teacher. So online teaching is not only the PowerPoint. So they have to get the material, synthesize, and then see that it has to be taught, the relevance has to be taught to the students, and should make the learning interesting. So that is the ethics of teaching learning process. That's why they said, I'll end it on one small anecdote. It's very interesting. I seen that there are various type of teachers, what you say. For example, a teacher who gives the information is called as Abhyapak. A teacher who imparts the knowledge and combined information is called Upadhyaya. A teacher imparts the skill is called as Acharya. And a teacher who is able to awaken the student is called Guru. That's why called Swadeshi Pujyate Raja Acharya Sarvate Pujyate. That means the real teacher is the teacher who awakens the student and is worshipped everywhere. Thank you.
Sir, one thing, sir. Can you please repeat that again? The one line that you said with PPT kills teaching. Can you please repeat?
The thing is that not generalized. Generally, many young teachers, they put the PPT, and if the PPT doesn't work, they can't teach. And they put the overhead, and whatever doesn't go to their head, they will present it as the overhead projector. So that is not the correct way. They have to understand first. They have to understand first. That's why we have excellent teachers. I should understand the topic first. Then only, see, the gradient has to come, no? The water cannot go from the lower to higher level. Similarly, concentration, temperature. So that teacher has to have a better gradient than a student. Then only the teaching learning process will be effective. That's what I feel as a teacher for the last 34 years. Of course, all panelists are all experienced people. They also definitely say that is. But along with this classroom face-to-face teaching, the institution should adopt online. Like I repeat, cake and icing. Cake should be the classroom teaching where it will be strong. Icing will be different, and it can change, adaptable to the his need and greed. Thank you.
So I think, sir, what is one takeaway that I have is Swadeshi Pujyate Raja Acharya Sarvatra Pujyate. This,
yes, this the real teacher is worshipped everywhere, but the king is worshipped only in the kingdom.
So, one thing that I have understood, the last line is, Vidwana Sarvatra Pujyate means we are going towards globalization of teaching.
Yes.
I think, okay, I will continue this talk with Dr. N. Rajendran. Sir, just as now Dr. Gopal Mugraya sir has said that the classroom teaching is the cake and the online teaching is learning. Do you feel, sir, what is the importance of blended learning? Are we now moving towards a phase where blended learning is going to be the future, where part education will happen in classroom and part will happen online? So in that case, we get the best of both the worlds. What are your views on this, sir?
Yes, Gurudev. In fact, Professor Gopal Rao rightly said, necessity is the mother of invention. In fact, only when we face certain crisis situation, we invent and reinvent ourselves. Now, as far as COVID situation is concerned, when the lockdown came on 23rd of March, in fact, we had certain issues before. One was that most of the departments, they have completed 85% of the portions, and another 15% of the portions yet to be completed. And the internal assessment marks need to be completed. And this was the real situation when the lockdown came. And when it was extended, then we have to find ways and means to overcome the situation. So immediately our faculty members rose to the occasion. I must say that our university, Harappa University, though situated like MKU in a rural area, it's a rural university by and large. But yet, so in the NAC, we have got 3.64 score, CGPA. And our ICT is very good. In fact, almost all the classrooms have smart class boards, smart boards with the smart classrooms. And the teachers are, to some extent, adept in using a technology to the effect. So we got together all the HODs on online, no one-to-one contact online. When I called them, they responded. In fact, 99% of the teachers, though they were away, some of them 400 kilometers away from the headquarters, yet they responded very well. And the first thing we informed them that they should complete the portions online. And they can use their laptops, they can use their mobile phones, whatever it is. First, inform all the students that the schedule of your lectures, schedule of your programs. And likewise, it was informed to all the students, and the students also very well respond, in fact. So, within a matter of 20 days, I got the feedback from all the heads of departments. They have completed the portions and they are ready for internal assessment. And we have given another 15 days for them to complete the internal assessments also. So all this process, normally it is done conventionally when it is done in a classroom situation where the teacher faces the students and the students give their responses, whether it is an assignment or a seminar and whatever it is, examination. But here, students are away from the classroom, they are in their homes. But similarly, the teachers also in their homes. That's the most important part of the thing. And yet, both of them connected together and they produced results, the much needed results. And I must say, this was the situation when our university first moved from this mere ICT situation to a digital learning platform. Because we established in the month of April, Harappa University online platform, which took care of the entire learning and teaching process. But here also, we need to tell one thing. The teachers, as Professor Gopal Rao rightly said, need some orientation. Mere presentation of your PowerPoint is not online teaching. Because when I am talking to you, though I can see you online, on screen, but yet when a teacher is teaching sometimes, the teacher is not able to see the students altogether. But yet he must teach as if the students are in front of him. That is, it requires a lot of imagination, lot of, say, creativity and art of teaching itself. So this was done by the teachers. Here I must tell you, there is a catch in this online teaching process itself. Most of the time the criticism that is leveled against online teaching is that the students may not be able to catch up this online teaching, because India is divided into rural and urban India. But in rural areas, only 14% of the students can access internet. And in urban area, it is nearly 42% of the students can access internet, say. But the students who stay in our campuses, 55% of the students are from rural areas. When they go back, and they stay in their villages, mostly. So this is a real situation. But yet, I must tell you that we can overcome this situation. They need not come online all the time and interact with the teacher. Those who can come online and interact with the teachers during the scheduled time, they can have the lectures. We have recorded all the lectures. We have recorded all the lectures delivered by the teachers. And these lectures were put on YouTube. So whenever it is, anywhere, anytime. And that is the type of lectures that we have prepared. Even if the students have missed a lecture by his teacher, that lecture is available in our website, in the particular departmental website. They can go there and log and then see the entire proceedings of the lecture. Thereby, sometimes some of the lectures delivered by in practical classes like cost accounting or anything like that, and the students were able to repeatedly see the lectures, learn from the lectures. So it is a great learning process for the students. Even in a real classroom situation, if a student is absent, if a student has missed some point of the professor or lecturer, definitely he cannot go back to that situation and recapitulate. Only thing is, he has to ask his neighbor and a classmate and to learn what the teacher has said. But whereas here, this online teaching, one advantage is that if it is recorded and replayed in YouTube, the students are at liberty in their leisure time. They can go through the lectures. Very leisurely, they can listen to the lectures, take notes. And in fact, the learning process is very high and the results are also very high. In fact, this is what we have learned from the feedback that we received from the students. They responded really well. And another important thing that we have said is that after preparing ourselves for the pre-examination processes, the teachers themselves, they want to be active. And hence, we said that each and every department should host teacher development, faculty development program or a workshop. And within a period of, say, a month, we had scheduled not less than 150 programs. And even today, as I am talking to you, there are more than 2,000 people, in fact, logged on to one of the programs of one of our departments. It's a very popular program. And in fact, we try to restrict to 1,000, but the number always grows to more than 1,000. One good aspect of the entire online teaching and learning platform is this is not restricted to our students alone, because students coming from entire country and even up, they are on to the our website. And once the lectures or the seminars are very creative and appealing to their minds, in fact, they join these lectures and very good feedback also comes. University like Ayyappa University, in spite of its geographical location, I must say the perception of the university is steadily growing and growing at a tremendous rate because of these online processes, online teaching, particularly the kind of webinars, workshops, and the faculty development programs that we have. This is a learning platform. In fact, we are also ready for online examination process also. But in fact, it all depends upon the other logistics that we have to receive the instructions from our state government. But there are certain issues involved in it. But at the same time, we never lag behind in preventing the COVID situation. Because our on the one side, the teachers were imparting knowledge. On the other side, for example, our skill development entrepreneurship for sale, they were preparing masks to be sold to the public. And these masks were not sold, they were given to the public. Particularly the district of Sivaganga district administration, we have given more than 5,000 masks. And all the faculty members, all the workers, non-teaching staff were given masks free of cost by this skill development department. Again, we have held several camps in and around our Karaikudi where this masks were distributed. Our chemistry department is preparing the sanitizer. We have appointed a nodal officer, who is a doctor in fact, our in-house doctor, and a team to monitor and sanitize each and every person entering the university with thermal machinery. And also the entire buildings are sanitized. On the one side, while we are imparting the knowledge, online knowledge system, at the same time, our sanitization as well as health care is also being taken care of. But at the same time, we also rendered a lot of help to the poor people, those people who could not afford, though lost their jobs because of daily wages, who could not be employed because there is a shutdown and they could not have their daily wages. For these people, with the help of some of the banks as well as organizations, and we have given to the tune of nearly 5 kgs of rice to 10 kgs of rice, groceries and vegetables periodically every month at different junctions. So these are the ways by means by which both the socio-economic aspects of the COVID as well as the on the educational front, we were able to say face the COVID situation. I must say,
congratulate you, sir.
Online teaching is one good effect of the entire COVID situation.
And so while rural background, but my experience has been a bit different.
Yes.
I have got my premium customers in Ramnathpuram, in Tirupattur, in Karaikudi, and the enablement of ICT in Algappa University affiliated colleges has really been amazing. Having said it, now moving on, as we are a bit short on time, moving on to Dr. M. Krishnan, to tell us about in brief about the ventilator that they have designed and that has got an approval from the regulatory authorities. Dr. Krishnan, please. Hello.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Actually, we have three programs.
Sir, there is an audio problem, I believe. Hello. Yeah. Sir, if you can please switch on your video, please. Hello. Okay. I think there is some problem. Moving on to, hello. Yes, sir. Am I audible? Okay. So we will wait for sir's audio to improve. And I would like to next move on to Professor Dr. Aditya Malik. Mm-hmm. Sir, I am audible to you?
Yeah.
Excellent. Sir, how do you believe, so we have heard Dr. Gopal Mugaraya saying, Dr. Rajendran saying about the importance of online and blended learning.
Yeah.
Right. How do you feel the seamless shift will happen from, from currently the offline to blended mode, wherein currently before COVID, the education used to happen primarily in classrooms. During COVID, it is happening 100% online. My question to you is, we have believed that am I audible now?
Yeah.
So, saying pre-COVID, the teaching used to happen in class. During COVID, the teaching is happening after early opening. We may have a blended way of learning.
I will mute automatically.
And the students who are coming from will be learning online. The campus will learn in classes. How do you believe, sir, will a seamless shift happen?
Okay, that's a very good question. We'll have to see whether it will be seamless or not. This is a period of innovation and creativity, and we have to think about also what is going to entail learning.
Please mute all participants. I'm sorry, we have 200 plus. Dr. Aditya Malik, you need to unmute yourself.
All right.
Sorry for the inconvenience.
No, that's perfectly fine. We've also.
I think this is one thing that we need to take care during learning also, right?
Yes. Yes, we're all still, familiarizing ourselves with this kind of online platform. And as you can see, this is an example of all the kinds of glitches that keep happening. So I don't know, whether it'll be seamless. It'll depend also on how campuses are going to reopen and when that's going to happen and how we're going to allow students back in and so on and so forth. Let me just share one of our experiences during the COVID period of online teaching has been that attendance for some reason has actually increased. We've had almost 75% attendance in classes, virtual classes. So, on campus, it's less. Students are not always going to class. Maybe they like to, spend time with themselves and go to the cafe and so on and so forth, move around the grounds of the institution. So that's one interesting feature that has definitely come out of this. Again, we have to think of, and I think, my other esteemed vice chancellors have spoken about, what is the role of the teacher now? So much content is available online, huge amounts of content. So starting to think of teachers and, as facilitators perhaps, but facilitating what exactly? Facilitating a student's desire or student's potential for their own calling. So educational institutions have to be places where one's own calling comes to the forefront. You create those kind of conditions. And we have to think of that because there's a tendency, at least especially here, in the subcontinent in India, to cram people's heads full of information. But that's not necessarily producing the kind of education that you need, especially out in the real world. All the people we talk to, industry experts say that when a student comes with a BSc or a BE or something, they're not equipped to deal with what's going on in the new, they have to be retrained. So that kind of shift has to happen. So even if we're going to do blended learning, it has to take into account the kinds of demands of the real world, and it may be in terms of doing projects, more project-based learning rather than classroom monologues. That happen with PPTs and so on and so forth. So project-based learning in which you learn different kinds of skills, you learn different kinds of disciplines come together. I'll give you one example, if I may. I know I don't want to take too much time. There's a robot that was developed, in a university in UK, Middlesex. It's called Pepper. So Pepper, involves artificial intelligence. It involves design. It involves movement of human beings, so biotechnology. So many different skills, students have to apply to develop something like that. So whatever that blended teaching would look like, I don't know exactly what it will look like. It has to be of a different kind of, we have to develop a different kind of pedagogy altogether. One that is more in tune with what's going on in the world today. Maybe more, globalized understanding of human beings and many other things have to come in. But certainly the teacher's role has to become one of a facilitator. So we are going to continue, as you say, with online teaching. It's been very successful. And like all the webinars and workshops and certificate programs and so on. And we'll be able to reach out to a much larger populace of rural areas. To reach out to students who can't come long distances to campus, for example. Delhi NCR, you can reach out to them. Okay. Somehow the experience of the campus is also important because, you know, we're all social beings. So we have to facilitate face to face. So anyway, that's, I hope that's somewhat answering your question.
Absolutely, and the one very important place where you have just touched and left, you have used the word industry. I would request Professor Dr. Abhay Kumar sir to address this. What do you believe is the importance of industry professionals teaching students? Now that we are moving towards a blended part, I believe already in every university or every campus, we have some involvement of the industry people.
Yes.
I hope I'm audible, sir, right?
Yeah, you're audible, and I hope I'm audible as well.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So now with us moving towards a blended learning part, you have availability of more industry professionals to your students because even they are working from home most of the times. So what do you believe will be the role of industry professionals in the current scenario, and by what percentage, approximate percentage, do you see that going up?
Yeah.
Over to you.
If I answer that, allow me the liberty because I am also having a background of the industry. So, in fact, we have been doing it in the past also. I am a very great and very serious proponent of the Guru Shishya Parampara, and mentorship has helped us in many ways during this pandemic. The faculty mentors have been talking to the students who have been opening their hearts to them. And that is the most important aspect which we have understood in this crisis. So apart from faculty mentorship, we have industry mentorship also in place. In terms of the entrepreneurship cell which we are having, we have faculty mentors as well as a few industry mentors for each student. So that is already going on. So the industry mentors, and having been situated in a hub where industry is prevalent all around, I think it is our duty to involve industry into so many activities of the university as well, which I have done in the past 1.5 years since I have been the VC here. We have involved industry and industry professionals not only during COVID time, because, you know, if we talk, if I quote you and say that there are so many layoffs and we can have very good minds with us, allow me to say that layoffs are of no importance. In fact, it is the best of the minds we must have. It is the best of the minds we must have, and layoffs are only for those middle management industry professionals, because I have very good contacts in the industry, so I tell you so. It is only those professionals who are not that tech savvy right now and who are not useful to them for either promoting a product or selling it. There are two aspects. So having an industry connect and an industry mentor, or whatever name you give it, is of utmost importance, not only now, but in every aspect of education. So the students, not only, as Professor Malik had said just now, that the role of a facilitator probably is not only to impart education or impart knowledge. The role of an educator is to allow the student to apply that knowledge, and so that an inclusive thinking process emanates from there. Now, if that is to happen, though I am myself a professor, and at an age like this, I can accept that many of the best of the professors in classroom teaching may not be that good in a virtual medium. So there again, training part comes in, retraining of teachers, which we have already asked our very senior teachers to start training themselves on all these platforms. So industry people are already very tech savvy, and I've come to understand that, because the sort of repeating they have to do every evening, so that makes them greatly tech savvy. So industry as a whole has to be a part of the education process, whether it is now, whether it is during the COVID-19 process or post-COVID-19 process. And I'll give you a very, very small example. Our Prime Minister has once talked about 5 vowels of a new normal, in which he talked about universalism, Honorable Prime Minister Modi. He said that we cannot remain isolated islands of excellence. I caught on to that. And what I did was that I thought ki sharing of resources was very important right now in the initial phases of the COVID-19 crisis. Many of us didn't have such very good professors who could prepare online lectures or YouTube lectures. So I had a collaboration with some of the private universities around. We shared our resources. That is the best part that has happened in the past 3 or 4 months' time.
I think and, sharing of something can be understood among state universities, but for private universities to share resources, this is something I have never heard of.
Yeah, actually, you know, one or two of the universities did not come forward, but once things started going and the sharing of resources came into the fore, they came back to us. Even I, as a person of management, I'll tell you, I have taken classes of a different university myself.
Wow.
So that process may begin. The process may begin.
I think I have never heard this before, sir. I think, we have Dr. Gopal Mugaraya who is
Half a minute, Gurudev. I was advisor in AICT. I had an observation. Many of the institutions are believing to have a smart classroom, smart system, smart software, but the smart teachers are missing. That exactly you have to emphasize.
Sir, I am with you, Dr. Gopal. In fact, in order to have smart teachers, the leadership has to be smart.
Exactly, yes.
I believe this. In every organization, whether it is a private university or a government university or a state or central, whatever it may be, if the leadership is of a nature in which even the faculty members are considered to be a part of the family, the VC, for instance, is a link between the management and the students and the teachers. I must tell you one thing. I have not seen my teachers working so studiously ever in the past as they have done in the 3-4 months' time. Right from morn till evening, even late in the night, calls have been coming. Examinations are going on right now. Even right now, a paper is being conducted online. And I can tell you, each of my deans has got 2 telephone mobile phones open. The students' queries are being addressed by the examination cell. And about 7 or 8 mobile phones are working continuously to address students' grievances. Now, and Gurudev, there's one thing I would like to emphasize on. You said, and a distinguished panelist said, that necessity is the mother of invention. Of course, it is. But then I also feel that necessity has become the mother of adoption also. Inventing is a new thing. Adopting is something which already exists, but we had never done so.
Absolutely.
So what has happened in the past few months is that what we could have thought of achieving in the next 5 years, maybe, we have achieved in the last 40-45 days. Online teaching has come to stay. And I am of the firm belief that it is a blended learning which would be the ultimate methodology and pedagogy. But right now, there is no other option. So we have to continue with online learning only. Once the students start coming to the classroom, then we can think of it. But then again, you know, there are so many questions to be addressed. Our universities, our colleges are all, mostly if I talk about private universities, because I'm a vice chancellor of a private university, especially, all the space we have utilized as per the eligibility criteria. So it would be telling for the infrastructure in terms of social distancing once the students come back to us. And suppose they are in good numbers. So we'll have to separate one section of, say, 60 or 50 into 2 or 3 sections. Will it not be telling on the part of faculty members to take classes in all those 3 sections? So it has to be a form of blended learning in the future, in the post-COVID-19 period. It would be partly classroom and partly online. It has to be there as I envisage.
Correct. And
moreover, what I personally feel is, that apart from this, and say just before COVID, about 3-4 months back, we had collaborations with about 2 or 3 industries, one with Hero Honda two wheelers and one with Okinawa electrical vehicles. And as probably some honorable VC has just said, that it has become multidisciplinary in nature now. That students would now have to shift towards the CBCS pattern. The universities would have to shift because, you know, it is the student's call now, whether he or she wants to study this or not.
I believe choice-based credit system and the credit transfer is going to play a very important role So imagine you have a student studying in Dr. Malik's University, and he's stuck in Shimla, and if Dr. Malik and Dr. Kumar are good friends, so he said, okay, why not let's transfer credits.
Exactly. Yeah. Why not? For you?
Good idea.
Absolutely. Good idea.
Imagine we have a student stuck in Karnataka, and we have Dr. Nagaraj Ramarao, and he has studied his 5 semesters in Noida, and for 1 semester he's stuck in his home. Dr. Nagaraj Ramarao, on a lighter note, sir, will you allow, and I am coming to you, will you allow transfer of credits? I'm saying this is on a lighter note, but my question to you is, what are your thoughts? And that, what is the importance of choice-based credit system or credit transfer during the pandemic? Since Dr. Abhay Kumar is said one word, he has given one point to ask the question. So what is the importance, you believe, in the pandemic situation?
All of us as academicians and being into the teaching for a long time would definitely aspire for this situation. This is a very, ambitious sort of a situation wherein the intra-university connects happen. But fortunately or unfortunately, all of us are governed by statutory systems, which sometimes may allow, may not allow a few things to happen. But yes, generally all of us aspire for it, and it is possible, and it could be done. That is one part. The other part is choice-based credit system has been there for quite some time, and all of us, even in my university, we have adopted to choice-based credit system for almost about 4 years now. And the credit transfers and taking up a course later, or taking up an online course, because UGC itself has allowed about 20% online courses to be taken by the students. So choose MPTEL or they choose Coursera or whatever, and they come back to us with those certifications, and those credits do happen. It's not new to any of the university systems. It is quite been there for quite some time. But along with this, I would like to bring one more point out. Because India is a large country, and we are always craving for resources, and we saw that even today here, because we got a 1G network connectivity, but still you'll have a lot of problems while actually implementing it. So what we have done in our university is, in terms of this classroom teaching, and as Rajendran pointed out, most of our students come from rural background. We had to cater to their requirements. We have brought in this capturing video lectures of the faculty, and then making available to the students on a login. Each student has been given a login and password. The student logs in into the his teacher or his or her teacher, and then the whole lecture is available to him offline as well. So that another intervention that has happened, and I think again it is a technological intervention which was needed during this COVID pandemic. Earlier asked about in what way the industry can support the universities in this pandemic situation. Yes, industry has been there throughout. Industry is part of the academics, and without industry, the blended approach will never come in. We have a specific intervention there for the option for the industry to come in a real way. There are something called as one credit courses, which industry offers for about 15 to 20 hours each semester. Student can take each one credit course and compensate for a 3 credit course. He can take 3 one credit courses and compensate for the 3 credit course. So that flexibility comes in from the CBCS system. The implementation of CBCS system in true letter and spirit is what is needed now, and blended learning is there to stay for a long time now. As Professor Abhay Kumar pointed out, the classes is going to be further split for the reason all of us know, the social distancing, You cannot put in those 60 students in one classroom. You cannot change the infrastructure in a day. So it is quite obvious that the classes will be, halved, or maybe you have one third of students sitting in the class, and you always have the handicap of a teacher incapable of teaching for the, round the clock. So it is the online teaching, the blended teaching, the video lectures, all stay for quite some time. Still, we actually come out of this situation as long as the vaccine or the medicine is invented for the pandemic. We will be into this situation for quite some time to come. And as I said in my initial observation, I see myself as a controller of an adaptive system wherein, there are faults and you try to repair the faults, learn from the faults, and come up with solutions and make the system still work with whatever it was working earlier. So it is a challenge for all of us academicians. As I said, the volume is quite huge. Looking into the state universities where you have lakhs of students coming from all parts of the country into these university systems, putting them all together on one single platform, organizing classes to them, organizing examinations to them, organizing practical classes to them. If it is an engineering university or a medical university, the situation is still worse because we do in the online teaching or blended teaching, you will definitely not be able to do in your practical classes, because practical classes demand a totally a different sort of a situation and different sort of a setup altogether. Yes, virtual labs are there. All of us have, brought in our own mechanisms in which you have put in your own virtual labs in play. But I don't know whether you are able to put in virtual labs for all the classes. It becomes very, very difficult for, a biotechnology course wherein you have your all processings, your upstream processing, your downstream processing. You have your chemistry laboratories wherein you need to do the sort analysis. How is it possible to do it online, and how is it possible to do it on a virtual platform? The challenges are galore, but I feel that we will definitely come up with the solutions, and we will definitely reinvent ourselves in terms of facing this pandemic in a much, much better way. We have already done it in the last 3 months. As I said earlier, we went without any preparation into the we made use of all the resources that we had and tried to still come out better with whatever solutions we had on hand. So I feel we are doing our best to fight through the situation and still come out with whatever possible, because we being education is our fundamental goal is catering to the requirements of the stakeholders, catering to the requirements of the students. And as long as we are able to do it in whatever best way possible with all the limitations, I feel we have been.
I would now, hello, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. You have really very well summarized. We are running a bit short on time. I can see Dr. Gopal Mugaraya looking at his watch. Don't worry, sir. We will not exceed the time. We have just 3 minutes left. With all of y'all permission, we would like to extend the time limit. And I now come to the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Madurai Kamaraj University to tell us in brief about the ventilator that he has developed for your region, and what has been the impact and how it has been appreciated. One more thing. I have been getting lot of questions from eminent faculties across. We don't have the time to take all questions, so we will be taking selectively 3 questions only. I would request the host to please give me 3 selected questions of the so many that you have got. After the talk by Honorable Vice Chancellor, we would be taking questions. The questions would be open to all the panelists, and anybody can answer it. All of them can answer it. Requesting Honorable Vice Chancellor of MKU to please share his thoughts. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Absolutely, sir. Loud and clear.
Yeah, actually, Madurai Kamaraj University, more than that, our teaching and learning process, all my Vice Chancellor talked about it. I want to tell three important processes going on in Madurai Kamaraj University. Number one, chemistry department, they identified or developed a chemical compound where when you are going to mix with that, what you called the, paint and other things, the virus can be, caught out and then it will not spread over the room. Like that, they, develop a chemical compound for which central government has given near about 25 lakhs rupees for the research, the professor who is doing the research. That is the one thing. Number two, one of my physics professor identified the ventilator. What it's a important thing on the ventilator is, actually the ventilator is going to work with the nanomaterials. The nanomaterials, where it's going to supply more oxygen to the, what you called the mask. Because when you are going to wear the mask, so much of time, it's going to give you a less oxygen for your respiration. A normal person is not going to have any problem. But a person is having a respiratory problem. When you are going to wear the mask, the oxygen available inside the mask will be the very less. So that nanomaterials, what they packed inside the mask will supply, or they catch out more oxygen from outside and supply to the mask inside. By that, they don't have any respiratory problem. So the mask is ready by scientifically. We are looking for some industry where they can collaborate with that, because as such now, the mask cost about 500 rupees. But if once it's coming out with the industry, if you are going to manufacture too much, then we can give less than 100 rupees in each mask. The mask is not going to help during this COVID-19 process, but also it will help wherever you need more oxygen. That mask will help you to supply more oxygen inside the mask. That is physics professor developed the technology. Number three, he developed one instrument, a small instrument cost about 50 rupees. By that, blood or any sample of that, the infected patients can be collected and put it in that, what you called the instrument. The easily you can identify that the patient is having virus or not by saying that what you called the current meter, we can identify that one. That also he invented. So the two are ready for the industrial collaboration. So many industries are coming forward. So we are going to deliver very soon in collaboration with the industry and the permission of the government, we can release the two important investigation from Madurai Kamaraj University, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. We will be now taking some questions. It is 5 o'clock already and I really respect your time. So quickly, we'll be taking a few questions. Give you some stats, at one time we had some 250 participants in this meeting. Currently, we have around 200 participants.
The whole exercise of this is the education before COVID, education during COVID, and education beyond COVID. Exactly, this is the crux of our idea. Now, as you know, all of us are teachers. This is a very valid point. You know, you are a too young person, but it's very important that how much we learn in the class and how much we learn beyond the class. This is always debatable. But the answer is there in Upanishad. It clearly says, Acharyat Padam Adate, Padam Shishya Samedaya, Padam Sabramacharabhya, Padam Kalakramedacha. A student will learn only one fourth with the teacher, one fourth from his own intelligence, one fourth from the class sub-particle, that means classmates, and one fourth from the life. So what we talk here is about one fourth, what he learned in the teaching learning process. But we have to create for other three also, that we have to enlighten his sumedha, that means his intelligence. He has to create a good ambience with his sahapatis, that means co-friends. And also, we should create a life learning process. We have to educate our students how to learn. We have to teach them how to fish, not get them fish. This is the point.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. I now will take two questions from the audience. This question is asked by Mr. V. Hari Krishna. The question is related to examinations. I was very sure that we'll be getting these questions today. If exams could not be conducted, on what basis students may be promoted, sir? I'll again repeat the questions. If exams are not conducted, on what basis should students be promoted? I now ask anybody from the panel to please come forward. I believe all of you have been doing this day in and day out, framing examination rules. So, anybody please?
Yes, President. Malik sir.
Huh?
Malik sir.
Okay.
If I can.
Quickly. So, just very quickly, because I know other vice chancellors would like to speak. We actually conducted the examinations online. So it was the very first time we did that. We had an in-house ERP system, and we devised a MCQ, very short MCQ for students to go through. And the results, in fact, are going to be declared by the end of this month. So everything was done online and on time also. But it was a new experience. But we also thought one of the possibilities, and UGC has also mentioned this, to base the final evaluation on proportionally on what students have, how they performed in earlier evaluations during the year. So for example, if you have three sets of evaluation, then you can do it proportionately if you're not doing an online examination or not doing an examination on campus. But basically we did an online examination for the students. So does that answer your question? I mean, partly can be done proportionately.
Absolutely.
Some cases, of course, they are just passing, they're promoting students without further, hindrance. But this is common knowledge, I think.
I would also request Professor Rajendran, sir, to address this query here. Since, sir, you are a state university with more than 100 affiliated colleges, I'm sure you would have solved this issue. Can you throw some light on this, sir, that without conducting examinations, what is the process to promote students?
No, because we are under a choice-based credit system, number one. And this choice-based credit system is a continuous evaluation that takes place. And it is not the final exams alone that counts. This has to be kept in mind. So you have two, the examination will be two halves. One is the internal evaluation or internal assessment. This is, of course, the external examination, which is 40-60 or 50-50 or something like that. But apart from that, as my earlier panelists rightly pointed out, it is a question of consistency, law of consistency. Say any good student who has been performing well right from first semester to that of the last semester, the whole question is, boils down to the last semester, that is the final year students, because their future is at stake, because they have to complete their studies and go for further studies or go for placement. So naturally, we are in a position to declare their results. Under such circumstances, it is all the better to take into account their earlier performances and do an averaging and then add it with the internal assessment that has been done for the last semester and declare the result. I think in most of the cases, we may not go wrong. That is my answer.
Absolutely. I mean, during a period when saving lives is more important, in a career span of 3 years or 4 years of a student in graduation or post-graduation, we can always have one examination that can be conducted in a different manner. Importance is the teaching and learning process. Examination is just a stamp on what the student has learned. So, especially when we already have CBCS, it becomes really easy for us to, you know, evaluate the student on the basis of his previous marks. One last question before I wrap this panel up is, I'll just read the question. What is the formula to decide the composition of classroom in online and in class? Or, so our audience has given us an or question. Being academicians, when they set papers, there always has to be or. So what factors will be considered in such a breakup? And can technology help take such a decision? I have an answer to this, but before I answer, I would request my esteemed panelist that please answer this. Anyone?
Can you give it in one line? What exactly do you want, Gurudev?
Yeah, just repeat the question.
Okay. So how do you decide the composition of classroom post reopening? How much will be online? Who will be online and what will be in class?
There's nothing, if you permit me to say so, I'll answer it in just 4 or 5 lines. As we have already discussed during the discussion right now, that post-COVID-19, it has to be a blended learning process. And of course, classroom teaching has to be there, practicals would be conducted as and when the new normal set in. But then online teaching is there to stay. If you talk about percentage, let's make it 60, 40, 80, 20, whatever is the best possible at that point of time. If you want me to, can I interrupt for a minute about something very different which we have done?
Please go ahead, sir. Please go ahead.
You know what happened was, being in a private university, we had certain challenges. Our management was very worried about the salaries to be paid to the faculty members in the months to come. So I took webinars with parents, 50 parents each of 5 webinars, along with the student during the webinar. And when I asked them, do you really like your teacher? Everyone said yes. And the way he or she teaches is wonderful. Then I said, please try to give the fee if it is possible for you to. And I tell you, I termed my teachers as corona warriors. I said security forces as well as health workers are corona warriors, but the teachers are also corona warriors at this point of time. And you as parents must help them. Now, you have to ensure in the school system, the school authorities are asking the parents to sit with the children. I said, no, ask your students to attend the classes online. And a time is going to come soon in the next few months when they'll be there in the campus as well. And don't fear. This fear party should be removed. So to answer this question, I say that the student and parents also have to decide how much percentage of classroom teaching they require and they really want in the months to come, and how much percentage of online teaching can be good for them. So it is a mutual consent which is going to evolve into a system in the months to come. It cannot be just taken a decision of the percentage right now. This is my view.
Okay. So I would also, with all of your permission, I would also like to share what we have done in this. So MasterSoft basically is a campus management solution provider. We provide campus ERPs to institutions across the country. What we have done is, in the online admission form and the student registration form for universities, we have added some fields like what is the block number from where the student is coming, what is the city block number, ward number, because across the country, the containment zones are defined on the basis of blocks and wards. So apparently, automatically, our system will tell the colleges that this is a student that is, that can study from home because he or she is coming from a containment zone. And these are the students who are coming from green zones. So for a institution like National Institute of Technology, Goa, Dr. Gopal Mugaraya sir is here. Sir, you are a national institution. And you will be having students coming from across the country. Being a NIT, you will have students coming from across the country. So what are the steps that you would be taking so that whenever after 1 month or 2 months the institutions reopen, how do you ensure that people from red zones continue learning online?
Let me answer this. Today's green zone is tomorrow's yellow. Diakon was our own. When I told it red, to Goa was the zero. It was back, it was a complete zero. And now it's more than 1,000. But you know, we believe in treating the cause, not the symptoms. So we have decided now that as a 3 months come what may, we'll go for online. Because we don't want to take any risk. Because when the student comes, see, the physical distancing is not possible. Student, we can make them distance in the class. Whatever the hostel, whatever the road, they'll definitely, because that is the age, they'll be playing. So there's no point talking in social distancing and keeping them in the, it's not practical. So another 3 months, we'll for online teaching with the virtual classroom also. I'm a strong debater of virtual lab. You should see, I was in Surakkal for 25 years. There is a virtual lab existing. It's worth mentioning that lab will the very important point, that lab will facilitate the student to form their experiments virtually. Not that they'll do a titration through virtually. It will guide the student to formulate the project through the virtual lab. So it has to come. The teaching learning has to change now. The concept of evaluation has to change. It has to change because COVID has come as a blessing in disguise for us. Let us accept it and we have to adapt. Unless we adopt ourselves, we will not proceed further in life. This is a message we have to give to our students. And this is the right time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. We also have a very special guest. We have a very surprise guest for all of you today. I won't call him a guest. He is our Managing Director, Mr. Shyam Somani, who comes from academic fraternity amongst all of you. He worked at Nagpur University for 12 years as the head of the Department of Computer Center. I would request host to please put him in spotlight. He is an academician like you who shifted his gears and came to this. We have him for thanking all of you. Over to you, sir.
He's a great human being. First of all, he's a very humble man.
Thank you, sir. Vidwan Sarvatra Pujate. This is a very, very important line. And today it is a lifetime opportunity for me that 6 most renowned vice chancellors and the directors of the India are sharing their experience together for the betterment of the students. Great work has been done by various authorities, various vice chancellors in the field of research and development for COVID. Lot of work has been done by Vice Chancellor for research, especially ventilator creation, sanitization creation. We have to adopt new technologies and already we are running out of time. So I won't take much of your time. I listening to all the 6 members was an opportunity for me. I would like all the Vice Chancellor, Dr. Professor Dr. Rajendran Sir, Vice Chancellor, Algappa University, Dr. Gopal Mugraya Sir, Director, NIT Goa, Professor and Dr. M. Krishnan, Vice Chancellor, MKU University, Professor Dr. Aditya Malik, Vice Chancellor, KR Mangalam University, Professor Abhay Kumar, Vice Chancellor, IEC University, and Professor Nagraj Rama Rao from the Kalasingam University. I thank you all, sir, for the nice discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. On behalf of MasterSoft, I would like to thank all of you. I would also like to thank the audience who have been listening very patiently to us. This video will be there on YouTube very soon. And I fold my hands, bow to all of you. Thank you so much for joining us. I look forward to meet all of you in person and have more wonderful conversations once this is open. Let's all pray that things come back on track normal, whatever may be online. But the feeling when we meet each other, when we shake hands, when I seek your blessings, I think nothing can replace that. So it has really been.
Till then, we have this online blessing for you. Till then, we have
online blessings. truly, sir, I feel very blessed to have all of you, my esteemed audience. Thank you so much. And I look forward to meet all of you and, you know, continue these discussions. If there is anything that I can do for you when it comes to remote learning, etc., anything that has to do with remote learning, going digital, I am just a phone call away. One small request, we would be now having a group photograph. So this is a virtual photograph. So I would request the host to please click pictures. You can remove me from spotlight and we can come to a gallery view. And everybody, please say cheese, please smile.
Please.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. I again thank you from the bottom of my heart for joining us. Your comments have been very valuable. We are going to release a paper for the same, and maybe by end of next week, we would be sharing this with you. We have our other panel discussion on 29th. I would be sharing a leaflet of that as well, and hope that you join us there also. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to all the panelists, the esteemed panelists. Thank you, Gurudev. Wonderful. Thank you.
Yes. I am what? Okay. 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 Okay.